And perhaps most notably, he was the front man of Ultravox. He's Midge Yeo, and he joins me now. Morning, Midge.
Good morning, Cam. That's a damn fine Scottish name you've got there.
Oh, thank you very much. Although, you know, my mum liked the name Cameron. That's how I got it. I've got no connection, unfortunately. But people always pick up on that, especially if when I've gone north of the English border before.
Of course,
now.
Of course.
So you've got a solo album out at the moment and a single on the way as well. But first, can we go right back to the very start? And what was the first band, the very first band that you were ever in? Can you remember?
Yeah, I started being pretentious very young, as you can imagine. And my first band was a band called Stumble, and it was named after an old Eric Clapton blues tune that I used to listen to when I was an aspiring guitarist living in the slums of Glasgow. And we weren't a blues band. We didn't know how to play the blues, but we stole the name and used that.
And then I guess you've just been in bands all your life, really.
Well, I have. It's funny, if you look back at my career, it looks like I'm a dreadful old musical tart, and I just seem to jump from band to band, but it didn't really work that way. You know, you join a band, you become kind of fairly well known in your area for being, you know, reasonably good at what you do, and then you're picked by another band to go and in a slightly larger band, and you move on, and then you move from Glasgow to London, and you join another band, and it just kind of happens. I've just been incredibly lucky that the bands I've been in have either been notorious or famous.
Could you put a number? Do you know the actual number of bands that you've been in?
No, not at all. I mean, it's not that many. I mean, most of them, as I say, were kind of famous. You know, back in the 70s, my first real band, Slick, you know, had a number one record, and then that all disappeared very, very quickly. And I moved to London and I joined the Rich Kids, which was a band formed by the original bass player in the Sex Pistols, a guy called Glenn Matlock. And then I bought a synthesizer during the Rich Kids, and the band hated it. Half the band absolutely loathed this thing. And I wanted to introduce the synthesizer into this rock band. And from that, I formed Visage as a studio project. And through working on Visage, I joined Ultravox. So, and with a bit of Thin Lizzy in the middle there somewhere. So, yeah, I mean, it's sometimes you carve out your own career, and that's kind of what I've done.
Yeah, I was going to say, because you mentioned Rich Kids there and Thin Lizzy also, quite sort of rocky bands. And then, I mean, I suppose you were the front man of Ultravox, and it's a very different type of music. Was a synthesizer, is that your sort of favourite sound for a band?
Well, I think Ultravox were certainly the band. The moment I joined the band, although the band didn't have anything going for it at all. They'd just been dropped by the record company. Their singer and guitarist had just left. They owed a fortune to the previous record company. There was no real future as such. But the moment we made a noise, it was the most stunning, magnificent noise you'd ever heard in your life. And that was the combination of all instrumentation. So the viola was just as important to Ultravox as the drum machine, and you know, the guitar was just as important as the synthesizer. So it was the combination of instruments that was really important. We very, very rarely did something that was totally electronic. And if you listen back to the first album I did with the band, which was the Vienna album, there's guitar all over that, because that's what I am first and foremost. I dabble with keyboard synthesizers, but I'm a guitar player.
You mentioned that the band, that the Ultravox, really didn't have the brightest look of looking futures when you first joined. I mean, did that just not matter to you at the time then? You were all about the music?
Absolutely all about them. Always have been all about the music. You know, especially coming out of a band like Slick, which was a kind of not a manufactured band, but the music was very manufactured. It was written by the same guys who wrote the Bay City Rollers records and produced by them, and you had very little say in what you were actually doing. So I tried to move a million miles away from that. So the idea of joining Ultravox musically was just fantastic. I felt as though I'd come home for the first time in my life. So the future of the band and the potential success of the band wasn't even in my radar. You know, it was all about getting in there and writing some music and making interesting sounds.
We've mentioned all these different groups that you've been in. I mean, what do you think is the key to making a band work?
I think I'm asked this a lot by young musicians who are just about to embark on a career in music, and one of the key elements is songwriting. And when I joined Ultravox, I'd written a handful of songs, but they were kind of like you could see the DNA jumping out of them. You know, you'd hear a song and it would sound exactly like David Bowie, or it would sound exactly like Roxy Music. You know, whatever you happened to be listening to at that moment in time was your influence, and the influence shone through. But you have to kind of start like that in order to start finding your own feet. You know, there is nowhere you can go and learn how to write a good song. You can learn how to write a song structurally, but that doesn't mean emotionally you're very good at it. So when I joined Ultravox, it was such an exciting creative period. That's when the songwriting really came to the fore. You know, from leaving Slick to joining Ultravox was only 3 years. So with Slick, I had no say in the music at all. And with Ultravox, one of the first things we wrote was Vienna.
Speaking of Vienna, actually, I've had a question come in from Robert, who's a cameraman, and he worked on A History of Rock and Roll, apparently, he says, and he heard that Freddie Mercury's cat was called Vienna, and he's wondering if the Ultravox song Vienna has anything to do with the cat.
I think it's probably got more to do with the comedy Rising Damp, Leonard Rossiter's cat was called Vienna. I'm not sure Freddie Mercury was a massive fan. I only ever met him once after Live Aid. And we shook hands and said hello, and he mistook me for the guitarist of the Boomtown Rats. So I don't think he was a massive Ultravox fan.
No, it doesn't sound like it. Now, as a rock star or a pop star, you've got fans who adore absolutely everything you do. People will cheer you. People want to speak to you. They want to hear from you. People want your signature. All of a sudden, it becomes sought after. It's got to be hard to actually keep your feet on the ground at the best of times and not get swept up into yourself. But you sort of managed to do that, and even actually go in the opposite selfless direction, founding Band Aid with Bob Geldof. I mean, how did that iconic record come about?
It was quite simple, really. We'd seen the footage on television. Bob was very, very moved by what he'd seen and disgusted by what he'd seen on that initial footage that we saw from the BBC. And we decided we wanted to do something, and we're not skilled at doing anything at all other than making music. So we decided that what we should do is call upon all our friends, as many friends as we could muster within the music industry, and write a song. Because 50% of the money earned from a record goes to the songwriters. So we wrote a song, Do They Know It's Christmas, and donated the songwriting royalties to the Band Aid Trust, and hoped to raise £100,000. And of course, it raised £7 million, and then led on to Live Aid, which raised even more and still does today. So, yeah, it was a fairly straightforward task, but a strange task. I've never sat down and written something specifically to try and achieve success. And that's what we did with Band Aid. We wrote a song that we wanted to get to number one to generate income to try and send it off to Ethiopia and alleviate some of the horrors that were going on there.
And how did you go about actually getting all the people together? Was it as simple as just sort of flicking through your phone book and saying, oh, yeah, we'll get them on?
Well, everybody knows Bob. You know, I'm kind of the invisible man, really. You know, I can blend. I'm like a chameleon. I can blend into the background and nobody sees me. But Bob is so loud and big and gregarious and OTT that everybody knows him. So by the time I'd gotten home after our initial conversation and written a little melody, the da 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 thing, and Bob had already bumped into Gary Kemp from Spandau Ballet and Simon Le Bon from Duran, so he'd already started rounding all these people up because they all lived in the same area of London, so it was reasonably easy getting them all to commit to doing it. The thing that we didn't really think about was that we hadn't asked an adult to write down the times and dates and places of where it was we were going to record it. So we'd only spoken directly to the musicians. We didn't know who was going to turn up on the day.
I'm trying to think as well, if anything like this happened before. Like, is the, I mean, I can't think off the top of my head of any sort of big sort of super group forming like this for a cause before.
Yeah, there was actually a few years before George Harrison from the Beatles had done a big concert in New York, I think, called Concert for Bangladesh, and it was to help the poverty-stricken children of Bangladesh, you know, dreadful scenario over there. And weirdly enough, George was the first person to give us any advice when we said we were about to do this, and he said, "Get yourself good accountants."
And a diary, maybe.
And a diary and a pen, and have an adult intermediary between you and the rest of the artists. But he gave us the advice because his charity, though it raised a lot of money, all the money went on overheads, all kind of disappeared, and he was furious about it. So we did. We took his advice and did exactly what he said, and that's the result.
It's a shame, that, isn't it? All that the good work that's gone into it, and just because a few boxes haven't been ticked in the right way, some of the money doesn't go to the cause.
Well, it just gets eaten up. It's not that it's been absconded or disappeared in the wrong places. Yeah. It's just that, you know, overheads, you know, cars, bikes, phones, you know, wages, all of that stuff. Band-Aid, we didn't do anything. We begged, borrowed, and stole. whatever space we could get. There's never been a Band-Aid office, and there never will be. You know, we've never spent money on sending a letter by motorbike in London or whatever. It's all been, we've bludgeoned people and gone into their offices and taken their telephones over for a day. That's kind of how we did it.